If this is life, then mine has only been a dream. For now I know the truth. The world holds secrets all around us, and only few of us can see them. To be paranoid is not an option. This is my reality, but it's sadly not ours. You must look beyond the obvious, because it's there to cloud the mystery. Welcome to An Hour with Domino. What you just heard was a little quote from one of my newest books called Moonbeam, which we will talk about today. I also have Miah back on the show with me. Say hello, Miah.
Hello. Thank you for having me on, hon.
Oh, you're welcome, Miah. I always like having you on. I know you've been on for, what is it, the last few times now?
I think I've been on two episodes. I'm not sure. I'd have to go check.
Yeah, two episodes.
I don't listen
episodes.
To the show.
Well,
I was there, man.
I hope everyone's doing well. I know it's going to been a few months since I've made one of these episodes. I believe this will be episode 5.
If not,
I will have it corrected. 5 or 6.
You've had a good reason for not having...
Oh, yes. I was not only finishing a book, but I was doing other creative projects. And, it's been kind of a busy summer so far, hasn't it?
Mm-hmm. I've been there for all of it. Somehow, you actually were able to write up and finish a whole book. Like, that was pretty cool.
Yep, and... just took a little bit over a year. Yep. A year and a few months to write.
But, like, you had a huge spurt of creativity, which is always mm-hmm. really cool to witness. Very inspiring.
As of right now, though, now that it's finished and published, sorry about that.
You're a writer, not a speaker.
Yeah. Now that it's all finished, I'm having kind of... I don't know what I really want to call it. My creativity has been all over the place. I cannot focus on one thing. I've been doing several different creative tidbits here and there. I don't know why.
Perhaps it's you almost don't know what to do with yourself because you were dedicating so much time to creativity. And now that one project you were focusing on is done, your body doesn't know what to do with itself. So mm-hmm. it's just... searching for anything.
I have other books that are currently in progress, and I have been adding paragraphs and chapters to those off and on mm-hmm. the last few months, but yeah. I will give a full announcement, though, the next time one of my new books goes out. We're going to talk about a few different things today. One recent news... as of yesterday of this recording, the very famous Aretha Franklin has passed on now, the Queen of Soul. I actually really loved her music. She made me love soul music in general. You remember her from a few different things, right, Miah? Like the Blues Brothers?
That was where I first heard about Aretha Franklin was the Blues Brothers, and I actually bought a cassette tape of hers after that. So somewhere, I don't know where...
We gotta find that.
Probably in a closet somewhere, there's an old cassette tape of Aretha Franklin.
And that would be worth something. Cassette tapes are no longer being made. Or have they come back?
They're coming back. Cassette tapes are, for the sake of nostalgia, are coming back. They don't sound good, like in comparison to a CD, but they're coming back for the sake of retro, you know? And, mm-hmm. you know.
Almost the way vinyls right. came back, but...
Yeah, but...
those are steadily being played.
And this is an argument that's been made about vinyl versus tape, is the huge difference is vinyl does have a unique sound to it. you know, not saying tapes don't have a unique sound, you know, the warbling and the warm hum of a cassette tape is a very unique thing, but it's not a likable thing to a lot of people. The hum and the warmth of a record is, for some reason. Tapes somehow have a less desirable sound to them. I'm kind of in the camp of people who believe that tapes are just something people are clinging to for the sake of being retro. Mm-hmm. I hate being like that, but I do kind of believe that nobody wants tapes. Nobody likes tapes. It's just they want to bring them back for the sake of being retro, you know?
Yeah, that happened in the 80s. People referenced the 50s and the 80s.
The thing is I don't know why people would bring back something inconvenient for the sake of retro, you know? There's an advantage to having records.
They last.
Tapes are a slight inconvenience, in my opinion.
Yeah, cars don't have them in their stereos anymore.
Yeah.
They barely have CD players anymore.
I mean, it's like the people who want to bring VHSs back. You know, why bring VHS? There are some. There are some people who want to bring VHS back, and they can't give any legitimate reason why. They just want to bring them back because they're retro and they're quirky. And there's no upside to them. They're bad quality. You have to rewind them.
Yeah.
And they take up a lot more space, and they're flimsy, they're delicate, they fall apart.
It's just nostalgia.
Degrade. Yeah, it's just...
Nostalgia. Really.
I hate using this word, but it is hipster. It's the hipster factor. It's completely inconvenient and unattractive, and yet people want to do it just for the uniqueness of it.
Mm-hmm. But. On the recording of a vinyl, you can hear everything... And sometimes, like on older ones, you can hear the producers in the background by accident, of course.
Mm-hmm.
But I've always found that to be fascinating. Vinyls themselves are recordings of history. It's like revisiting that moment in time.
Mm-hmm.
And it always lives forever.
I was recently looking at this picture of Aretha Franklin in the studio. And she was holding it looked like a condenser microphone. But she was holding it like a normal microphone in her hand.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that was weird at first, but then I kind of remember that's all they had in those days. They didn't really have specialty handheld microphones.
Yeah.
Like studio microphones were these big, delicate pieces of machinery. And, you know, you had to use what you could. I think it was some sort of Sennheiser or something, sort of boxy looking. I forgot what they're called. They still make them. They're like these super cardioid boxy Sennheiser condenser microphone or dynamic microphones, actually. But they're just old fashioned looking. And
if anyone wants to know anything about microphones, definitely ask Maya.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember names of microphones. I can recognize them. I can recognize a microphone just by looking at it now, and like looking at old pictures of Aretha Franklin recently, like I noticed she was singing into a Shure Beta 87 in at like a Super Bowl performance or something. And used to, I'd never noticed that before I started really getting into microphones and stuff. But now I do.
You know what I always thought was interesting, looking at pictures of singers in the older days when they were recording in the studio? I always thought it was interesting when you'd see the microphones hanging above them, dropping down in front. I had never seen ones like that until like on the back of old album covers and stuff. I'm not really sure what kind they were or anything, but I really liked the retro look to them. And
A lot of the times microphones really haven't changed too much in their designs or how you set them up over the years. A lot of it does have to do with just the convenience of how you want them positioned. Like for a lot of people, they only hang them upside down like that because like hanging from the ceiling, because if they stood them up, it would get in the way of your scripts or your lyrics or something like that. And
I guess that's why they would have him hang like that.
I remember seeing this performance of, I don't really care for her, but I saw this performance of Tori Amos, and she was playing at a piano with a blue, which is a brand of microphone, a blue, I think it was a baby bottle, they're called, condenser microphone, and it was upside down while she was playing. And the reason why is just simply because if you move this big, tall condenser microphone in front of you, there's no way you could position it properly in front of you.
Yeah.
So they had to turn it upside down and put it in front of her. And a lot of people do that. I've actually done that. I've recorded with condenser microphones upside down just to kind of test it to see if it works, you know, better than having a microphone in front of me. But because of the way that I usually record things musically, I record them usually one track at a time, and I have to be in control, the computer too. I usually just have a boom mic that can move forward and backwards in front of me so that I can do different takes. And it's a bad thing, but because I have to sing sitting down, that's not very good when you're a singer, unless you're a pianist or something.
Well, some of them can do it, but doesn't it, for the most part, restrict how the air flows through you?
Yes, it can constrict your bellows. It can constrict your stomach and your lungs, where you collect your air and push out and stuff. There is a technique where you stand up straight and you have to play or you have to sing properly. A lot of pianists use it and stuff, or sitting guitarists and things, but it's really not good if you're studio recording. If you know, even though Billy Joel plays piano and sings, he didn't do that in the studio, I don't believe. I believe he played piano separately and then sang standing up later with a double track.
I wonder if Jerry Lee Lewis also did that. You know, he was a very famous rock and roll pianist.
That is an interesting thing in and of itself. I've seen pictures of, I think it was Fats Domino.
Oh, yeah, him too.
He played piano, turned to the side while singing into a microphone, standing up beside his bench. And that looked so uncomfortable, but that's just how they had to do it in those days because, you know, stages were usually to the left or to the right while a piano played to the side.
Another one, I guess, would be Ray Charles. He sat down too.
Ray Charles, he sang sitting down, but he somehow, because unlike Stevie Wonder has slight vision. He can see like shadows, I believe.
He's not completely blind.
So when he sings, he can see the microphone and stuff. Ray Charles completely went by ear. He would know where the microphone was by how he would position his body, and he could actually use the microphone as an instrument in and of itself by getting closer and further and using proximity effect.
It's that type of sonar that blind people have. It awakens in them, and they have like a sonar around them where things are.
Yeah. I actually once saw somebody flat out say that it was a lie, that blind people's hearing is ultra sensitive. And
okay.
Yeah. And
how would they know? They're not blind.
They were saying it as an absolute fact, and it's like, which is a lie, by the way, and stuff.
All right,
and the first thing that popped in my head was actually this show that Stan Lee used to host. It was like called Real Life Superheroes. And one of the guys he interviewed was this blind guy who actually developed sonar detection when he went blind.
Mm-hmm.
He actually could ride a bicycle, and he would make a sound, and he could tell what was beside him because the reverberation coming off of it, he could see the shape of it in his mind.
Just and like Daredevil.
They actually put it to the test. They put something beside him, and he had never seen it, and he made a clicking sound, and he knew precisely what it was. He's like, that's a fire hydrant, he said. Yeah. And it's like, very cool. So, yeah. Crap on anybody who says that blind people don't develop, you know, superheroes.
The body adapts naturally to how it needs to.
Yep. Anyway.
Well, everyone, starting off with the special announcements that we've been doing, we will get more into Aretha Franklin later. We're going to feature one of her songs today in one of the breaks. But also, let's move on to a little bit of Pokemon talk.
Pokemon.
Pokemon has been a little quiet lately, hasn't it?
It has. I think they're kind of regrouping, honestly. Yeah.
They're going to be releasing Let's Go Eevee and Let's Go Pikachu soon, which I'm glad not everyone thinks that that is the absolute next story-based game that's, you know, in a lineup. It's just a side game that they're going to do temporarily until the next main storyline game comes along with next year, probably. But, yeah, other than that, though, over the summer, they've been a little quiet.
They have. They have a lot to focus on. Nintendo, in general, is very shy to take on new ways of technology and society, which is why I think they've taken so long to kind of adapt to other gaming systems and other productions companies. Because they want to test the waters. You know, they kind of let Pokemon Go kind of slip by because they wanted to see, is this just, you know, a fluke? You know, is this just kind of a summer fling for a lot of young people? And to their credit, it kind of was. A lot of people did not enjoy Pokemon Go after the initial summer release of it.
Mm-hmm.
And the company, Niantic, was just very flawed and very slow and very underwhelming and, you know, weren't dedicated.
Kind of messed it up.
Yeah, they weren't very dedicated to their license, you know? They had a product, but they licensed out Pokemon and they had no clue what Pokemon was, essentially.
Yeah, don't mess with Pokemon's material because they'll take it back and they'll do it the way they want to.
And that's exactly what they're doing with stuff like Let's Go Eevee and stuff.
Yeah.
They've taken what they learned from Pokemon Go, figured out what works and what doesn't work.
Yeah.
And what doesn't work is third parties taking your material and trying to run with it, because they will fail and they will make you look bad. And it's kind of good that the Pokemon company is slowly but surely separating itself from Niantic, because in the end they didn't know what they had, you know.
Mm-hmm.
They knew they had a cash cow, but they didn't know about the product. They didn't know about Pokemon.
And when you get involved with the Pokemon company, you have to definitely know what it is and what their demographic is, who likes it and who doesn't, and what kind of formats will work with it.
Mm-hmm. And I also think the Pokemon company is taking that into mind as well, that, you know, lots of people are going to download an app. People who haven't watched Pokemon in 30 years are going to download an app to play it for an afternoon. But the people who are going to buy a physical game to play on Switch and stuff like that, they're Pokemon fans. They are the people dedicated who have watched the show, who have bought the mangas, who bought the toys, who enjoy the cards, who like Pokemon.
Mm-hmm.
So they've taken that into consideration, and they realize we don't want anything to do with an app right now. I mean, it took them forever to release an app. Remember when the whole world pooped itself at the idea of, whoa, Nintendo made an app, and it was Mario Runner. It was just a quick Mario game.
I think.
Yeah, that happened a few years ago, and they never released anything again. Because they were like, all right, we'll give it a shot. They did. They hated it. They moved on. Because they were testing the waters. Who is going to buy this? Is it Nintendo and Mario fans? No, it was Joe Blow who downloaded it and deleted it later that afternoon. You know?
Yeah. I know that Pokemon, a lot of people right now are excited to see the new generation of Pokemon coming, because they're ever so slightly hinting at it more and more. And
every time something's released, I think it's fake. Even when the Sun and Moon characters are being released, I was like, this has to be fake. this has to be fake.
You thought that about, I think you mentioned that even the last time we were talking, like, how you did not like Litton's evolution.
I would have loved if that was fake. That would have been awesome. But no, we got Tony the Litton.
Well, the beautiful thing about Pokemon is that when you train them, you do not need to let them evolve if you don't want to.
I suppose.
Some Pokemon don't want to evolve. Look at Ash's Bulbasaur, who has not evolved since the 90s.
Close your eyes, son. You'll be young forever.
Well, a part of Pokemon talk is also a part of games talk. And one game I actually am still very excited for and gotten a little bit more updates recently over the summer, especially at the beginning of August, is Dead or Alive 6.
Ooh, yeah, that's right. You're a huge Dead or Alive fan.
I am, very much. I love martial arts games in general, but Dead or Alive series has always been one of my favorites, along with Tekken. But I really love how they're taking a new approach to the game. They said that they want to tone down the sexuality of the female characters a little bit because they want to focus more on the fighting.
More on the sexuality of the guys.
They said that the female characters and the male characters are still going to be beautiful and attractive, both. But we're going to have them more focused on their actual skills and everything. And we know a little bit about it so far, especially since they just had an event for it at the beginning of August or the end of July. And they revealed some new characters that'll be in it, but we don't know all of them yet. And they're really taking their good old time trying to release all of them. And I know they're doing that on purpose to keep everybody excited for it, but
have there been any videos of the event in Las Vegas yet?
I don't think so. I could look.
You should. Maybe there's gameplay. Maybe they're showing some new characters and stuff.
They might. One thing, though, I noticed that, like, right after the event, nobody talked about brand new characters other than what was already known, and it's almost like they had a custom part of the game to allow people to play it.
I believe that. They would have a demo kit to play at the actual event.
Yeah, and that's what I'm thinking they most likely did.
I wonder if at the event they ran on computers or if they ran on systems like PlayStations or Xboxes.
Yeah, I wonder that too. I wonder if maybe they had all formats there for every person to who, you know, whatever they like to play.
Mm-hmm. Any guest stars announced at all?
No. So far, they have not announced who the guest characters will be.
And there usually are guest characters.
Yeah, usually. They've been doing that for about the last three or four games, core games. But I'm very excited for it. I really hope that a lot of certain characters will be back. And especially since, you know, characters that you like Neo Tengu, she was downloadable and we never got her, so hopefully she'll be mainstream in this one.
Any word if Elliot's going to be in it?
No word yet, but I think he will, because he was introduced as a primary main character in number 4, and he has been since then. So hopefully Elliot's another one of my favorite boy characters. So I guess we'll just have to see what they bring back. But you know that Dead or Alive is one of my favorite martial art fighting series.
Mm-hmm.
I've always loved martial arts games. I can't really perform martial arts myself because I'm limited with my condition I was born with. But there was a time when I was younger, as a younger teen or even a preteen, that I wanted to do martial arts myself, but I was limited because of that. So I got into the games really heavily and played them with my siblings. Of course, one of my siblings, and I think you probably could guess who, always tried to cheat or would get angry when I would win, saying I was cheating, and I told her, How can you cheat at a game where all the moves are programmed and you pretty much have to rely on your own skill?
I don't know. My brother used to, in Mortal Kombat, he'd corner me in the damn side of the screen and keep doing that side-to-side punch. And he'd just do it endlessly. He wouldn't let up. He would... just punching me. Ooh, ah, mm-hmm. Like you couldn't even block.
Sure he would remember doing that.
I guess technically if it's possible, it's not cheating, you know?
Yeah.
It's a way to look at it. If you're not hacking the system or...
You don't cheat at the game.
Gimping somebody's controls or something like that, then yeah, you're doing it fair, but it's frustrating as hell when they won't even give you a fighting chance.
Yep. Even fighting some of the boss characters, I've always felt that too, like they were a little bit overpowered or they just wouldn't give you the chance. The one in particular, Alpha, gelatin girl.
That gets kind of ridiculous.
She better not be back. I don't care what other characters come back. I don't want that one.
There actually was a game that was completely unwinnable that I played, that I used to have, and I still have it. It was WrestleMania 2000 for Nintendo 64.
You've played a lot of wrestling games.
This is actually one of my least favorite ones, and yet it was one of the ones I played the most. Just because it had such a large move set inside of it, I think, is what made me like it. Other than that, I hated the graphics. I hated the style. I hated the I hated it. I hated WrestleMania 2000.
Just an all-around bad game.
But I played the hell out of it. I'll tell you that. It was very weird, my relationship with that game.
Who were we watching recently who said nearly the same thing? Well, I know who we were watching, but remember he said that he used to play like an old fishing game and he hated it, but yet for some reason he loved playing it.
Yeah, it was the game The Deadliest Catch. It was based on the reality show Deadliest Catch for Xbox 360, that it was a crappy game, but you just kind of get obsessed with it. WrestleMania 2000... I was playing the career mode inside of it, and you can't play hard or easy in career mode. It gradually goes up, and the more important the match, the more difficult it is to win. And I had won everything. I won King of the Ring. I won Royal Rumble. I was doing really great in it. You know, I was spending like a week or more on it, working on it. And finally came the big championship match where I would win the heavyweight championship. And they put me in a cage match. I don't remember against who. It may have been Triple H or something like that, because he was being pegged already as the next big guy. So even in the games, he was way OP'd, way overpowered. But they put me in a cage match, and I played that game nonstop for a week, that single match, because I found out a way that if... they got over the top of the ring. First off, it was very cheap the way it was made, that if you went over the top of the cage, it would wait until you hit the floor for the bell to go off. And then for him, when his leg would just go right over the top, the bell would go off already, so you would know you've lost. But I found a way out of it that if I pushed pause real quick and like pushed restart match, I could keep doing it.
Yeah.
And I didn't turn off the Nintendo 64 for a week. It stayed on and stayed on pause for like a whole week.
Oh my God.
And
I'm surprised I think it'd hold up.
Nintendo 64 is pretty tough.
Yeah.
But I must have played that match over 200, 300 times. And there was no way I could win. That was it was over.
I would have loved to have seen like all the hours counted up that you had the game on, because it counts it up, don't they?
Some games do. But I would love to somehow figure that, like try to remake that situation, because I don't know if anybody else has ever mentioned it, how ridiculously difficult that ending was. I know my brother beat it, but his situation was different because he wasn't using a creative player. He was using the Undertaker in it. And he won the championship, and then at the end of the career mode, they strip him of his championship and hand it to Triple H, and then that's the end of the end of the career mode. So it shows you how pegged Triple H was to be the next big guy, that no matter what, he wins the championship. So nobody's ever mentioned that either, how screwed up that game was, that like you could not win no matter what, and even when you did win, they make sure that you lost your championship by having it stripped from you for some reason. But anyway, that was really my introduction. Well, not my first introduction, but my when I first really realized, yeah, I'm not crazy when I think games are ridiculously hard sometimes for no reason, like to the point where designers must be doing it just to be dickheads, just to be mean.
I remember when I was back when I first played Pokemon Stadium, when you go against the Elite Four. And other Pokemon fans might know this too. You go against the Elite Four. The Elite Four always attacks first. So you're purposely put at a disadvantage. They will attack first always, and their Pokemon are stronger than yours. So they will always pretty much win. You have to have a Pokemon with a great defense, and you have to know how to get around their attacks all at the same time in order to win. And it took me hours and hours to do it, but I did finally do it. I just remember getting really pissed off at the game. And it made me feel like they purposely would do that so that you would not win or make it overly challenging. If we ever play that on Domino My Games, you'll know.
Same goes for WrestleMania 2000. I actually did want to maybe someday do a special of just wrestling games, but I would want you to be able to play them first because all the controls are always different. Every wrestling game, the controls are slightly different and have different techniques to them.
We could do that.
It would be kind of hard. And at the very least, I want you to look at the creative players because
I love creative player in lots of games.
Creative player is always really fun. And that was one of the first things that made me really love wrestling games, was when they would have really good creative players. Nowadays, apparently, they're really good in the wrestling games. They're apparently really good. I think I talked about this last time on the show, actually. How last time I was on your podcast, I think I did talk about how limited wrestling games are now. That they make it so you can't edit women and stuff like that. And men have to be overly muscular. And
why even bother if you're not even gonna, you know, allow the player to change the character how they want them to look?
The weirdest thing is that literally you could at one time. So they made the conscious decision of, we can't give them this much freedom. We need to stunt them a little bit with create a player.
You know what? You just reminded me of another game that I'm also... It is out now, but I have not... We haven't gotten it, so I don't know. And I should look up to see how their character creation is. The new Soul Calibur.
Yeah, that came out, didn't it?
I want to know if we have the ability to make some of the males a little bit less muscular. Which, you liked all of my characters. I remember when you looked through all of my characters on there, I made 50 of them. Mm-hmm. And we showcased them on Domino Maya Games. And I've always wanted to make my own martial arts game with my own characters in it, and that was the closest I could get to it for now. But I want to know if they have create a character on the new Soul Calibur, and I want to know how well it is and how well it looks. I'm going to have to look into it a little bit more.
That's very surprising. A game that's made in Japan and stuff and has very Japanese looking designs to their characters, that they would not give men very much option with their body types, considering a lot of male heroes in in Japanese culture are usually depicted as being feminine or being slender or more than meets the eye.
I kind of wonder if the whole team was Japanese.
I wonder.
Because the theme of the game is not completely Japanese.
Yeah, it's very European looking, actually.
Yeah. So I wonder if they had other influences.
Perhaps.
It was a joint kind of contract or something. But yeah, definitely. I need to see if there's any videos on them of them online. Well, we might be approaching our first song break, actually. And you know what? It's summertime right now. I know that it's the middle of August, but it's still summertime, so we're going to have a summer song. And I take you now to Domino Radio. See you soon.
I'm gonna go back out on the coast, where the California boys are really the most. They walk that walk, they talk that talk, they stomp, they surf that surf. Yeah, they're out there having fun, surfing in the California sun. The boys are frisky and all frisco. You see a handsome little guy wherever you go. They walk, that talk, they stomp, they surf, that surf. Yeah, they're out there having fun, surfing in the California sun.
Well, hello again, and welcome back to An Hour with Domino. The song you just heard was California Sun, performed by Annette Funicello. The best version of the song, in my opinion, because she sings about boys. You know what? Now it's special guest time.
Very special.
Yes, I'm moving that up ahead of fun facts. We may or may not get into fun facts today, considering the amount of topics that we have. But that's okay, because we've kind of already done a few factual things already. Special guest time also combined with anime talk, and some of this will be kind of anime-oriented. Now, should we start off with what your brother requested?
My brother actually really liked our Naruto playthrough on Domino Maya Games, where we played the Naruto Shippuden Ultimate Ninja Alliance Bologna Sandwich, whatever, big long title, fighting game.
Ultimate Ninja Revolution, I think.
Yes. And
very fun game.
In it, when we played Toby from the Akatsuki, I mentioned about how he's like the Deadpool of Naruto.
You have cosplayed Toby for a video skit.
For a video skit.
Yes, along with Iowa's Deodata.
He's an easy character to cosplay. all you need is an Akatsuki robe and a mask, and that's pretty much it.
But you still have. You could do it to a con if you want.
Yeah, if I was lazy enough. Ooh.
Remember how many Tobies we actually did see at cons?
Yep.
So many of them.
In the video, I mentioned that, like, that when you go to conventions, which we go to a lot of anime conventions, you can oftentimes run into... Okay, first and foremost, I want to put out there that I in no way want to shame people, and I don't want to say you shouldn't have fun, and that you especially shouldn't have fun at an anime convention where you're there to have fun and dress up and just relax and let a part of you out, you know? I don't ever want to be that person who calls people out, especially about something as fun as cosplay. That being said... There are most definitely troublemaker cosplays.
Oh, yes.
There are cosplays that almost seem to draw people in who are just complete upstart outburst jerks. And I don't, maybe they're not cruel people, maybe they're not hateful, but they definitely see...
They cannot resist for some reason.
They see being able to embody this character for one day as sort of a chance to just let out some real frustration at the expense of others.
Oh, you know, I didn't think about that, and I definitely see it. A lot of people really get into the characters they portray.
Yeah. And, you know, that's kind of the theory behind fursuits, too.
I really loved being Bakura.
It's kind of the theory behind a lot of cosplay and fursuits in particular, because a lot of the times those are original characters, they're OCs, and you're in this huge costume that's sort of like a cocoon and blocks you from the rest of the world and stuff like that, and you're projecting this other self onto people, this other character. And quite coincidentally, it's usually characters like that within anime conventions that people cosplay that oftentimes they, for lack of a better term, just act like total asses when they are this character.
Yeah.
One of which is Deadpool. And there's there are whole series online about just people going to anime conventions and acting like jackasses dressed as Deadpool.
Yeah, photobombing, like, a lot too.
Yeah, that's the big thing. They love photobombing people's pictures, and
I hate when people do that in general.
They love just being...
It's a good way to piss me off.
And just like annoying people, essentially. Annoying people, getting in the way, doing somersaults and stuff down the halls and bumping into people and, you know, trying to put on skits and stuff. And granted, again, this is an anime convention. It's, for the most part, about having fun and dressing up and being able to embody these characters. But when you have that mask on and when your attitude is that you're a wild, crazy guy, for some reason... There are these characters that just completely take over someone, and they lose all proper judgment. And, you know, I remember, like, there were, what's a good example of something? Like, I remember people, like, running around with, like, you may not have seen this because I don't think you went to this con with me, but there was somebody dressed as Toby who was going around with like a meatball on a stick and stuff like that and trying to put it in people's faces and things and trying to get their friend to take pictures of them while they were trying to shove the meatball in people's faces and stuff.
I know what that is. It's the scene where him and Deidara are eating... the name of the food escapes me, but it's like a little ball of meat on a stick. Then they eat them in Japan, and they were eating it together, and it almost became a Toby meme.
Yeah.
Where he pokes himself in the eye.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, that's definitely a part of fandom.
And, like, it's just never ending with Deadpool is a thing. It's like, be prepared to be sexually harassed constantly if you are dressed like Spider-Man or any male character from Marvel, because that's basically, like, Deadpool's thing, apparently, is that he's in love with male superheroes, I guess.
He's in love with whatever he wants to be in love with, I think.
But, like, they... Like, somebody dressed as Deadpool will never ask for just a picture with you. They'll always want a picture of you while, like, can we make it look like I'm grabbing your butt or something like that? Or like, that I'm trying to grope you, or that, like, you're trying to hump me or something. And it's like, no, I'll take a picture with you.
Yeah.
And then they're just like, okay. And then they do it, and then they, like, make a dumb pose of some kind while you're trying to do your epic pose, and they take it too far. They take it way too far, and there's also, I shouldn't call him out, I really shouldn't, but there are guys who have, like, whole characters now, like, who just go to cons and just interview people and screw with them the whole time, and I don't know, it's a stress relief. It really is. It is sort of a stress relief to go to a con and just be around peers and relax and show, hey, I'm a part of this fandom and I appreciate this character, so I'm going to dress as them.
Yeah.
And then there are people who just take it too far and treat it like it's, you know, a damn playground and like it's playtime, essentially. Rather than cosplay, it's just play. And
there's also the people that just because you're dressed as a character, they think that you're part of the entire part of the fandom.
Oh my god.
To the point where if you dress up as a character in Yu-Gi-Oh, you must automatically already be in love with the Abridged series. I'm going to tell everyone right now, I do not like the Abridged series, and nor am I a fan of Little Karibo. I don't hate Little Karibo. He never did anything to make me hate him. I'm just not a fan. I'm getting that out there right now, but I do not like the Abridged series. I love Yu-Gi-Oh! For how it really is.
There are whole people who say that I am a Yu-Gi-Oh! Fan. I love Yu-Gi-Oh! Yu-Gi-Oh! Is amazing. They've never once watched Yu-Gi-Oh!
No.
They've only ever watched the Abridged series.
Mm-hmm. And you've experienced a lot of problems with that when you were in your Merit cosplay or when I was in Bakura. I think I got one thing. Think if somebody did try to call me Florence or something, but I'm not really sure.
I will never forget, I think it was before we went to Library Con. It was a convention being held at a library. And I actually said, I think the thing I can't stand most is when somebody shouts a complete stupid non sequitur at me. And it's usually something along the lines of, hey, you know, just for example, hey, toaster sandwich, huh? Toaster sandwich.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just like, is that a part of the Abridged series? And they're like, yeah, toaster sandwich. I don't watch the Abridged series. Dude, it's hilarious. Gotta watch it. And I just gave that as a silly example. And then we went to the con, and sure enough...
It happened to you.
Somebody did it. Somebody was literally like, hey, Florence with his leather pants or something like that.
Oh, Yami Merrick's leather pants.
Yami Merrick's leather pants, huh?
Which is apparently something,
and
with Merrick.
I literally was like, I knew it. I think I just turned to you. And I was like, I knew it, man. It's not an exaggeration. There are literally people who have never heard of Yu-Gi-Oh outside of the Abridged series, and I guess it's a good and a bad thing. At the very least, it kind of gave a slight rebirth to the Yu-Gi-Oh! Fandom. But at the same time, it's frustrating that it's something so
outlandish that now people associate. You know, life isn't totally serious. Life isn't all about being, you know, serious all the time, but it's kind of frustrating when it can't be, when it has to be ridiculous, non sequitur at all times. And
I don't really like what the Abridged series did to Yu-Gi-Oh!
Yeah.
Yu-Gi-Oh! Is actually a very dark manga story. There's a lot, and there's action in it, and but there's a lot of dark elements to it as well, and I've always appreciated that, and not everybody knows that.
I think that, like, you start to run into a lot of toxic fandoms, and I think that that just happens with anything, really, that has a fandom in and of itself. It's a clique. It's a group of people who connect on one thing, and that one thing is very sacred to them. So, yeah, it's, you know, like, nobody's going to go to, unless they have several cosplays planned, you know, nobody's going to go to a convention saying, I'm going to dress up as, you know, CL from Black Butler, but the whole time I'm just going to, you know, talk in my normal Southern accent. I don't really care. I'm just going to be like this the whole time. Hey, what's going on? You know,
They still show appreciation for the character they like.
It makes sense to be in character, but to the people who just go out of their way to just treat this as some lunchroom get together, my main thing is you're there to have a good time. Guess what? The people around you are there to have a good time too. Yeah. So don't get in their way. Don't get in the way of their good time by being a dummy and being annoying.
Don't force your own happiness onto others, or you know what I mean. Your own ideals.
I mean, like, I don't even know if the fandom is around anymore, and I don't want to like speak down about them if they are. Homestuck. When the convention we went to in Charlotte.
Oh, yeah.
It just got... It actually, its code name slowly but surely became Homestuck Con, because...
There was so much of it.
There was, like, sort of this underground sort of get-together of messaging and getting to know each other, where they actually said, hey, let's make this our con, you know? Let's get together, get everybody who loves Homestuck together, and we will converge on this con. And just coincidentally, it was that Charlotte con, and it sure enough, it became nothing but Homestuck, to the point where people were writing into the newspaper saying, like, why were those little girls running around with gray paint on their face and candy corn on their head? Why were they doing that? Why were they so loud and mean?
Yeah.
Why were they screaming, just do it, for no reason at each other? And
it was really obnoxious.
That's the thing. It became to the point where you girls, not just girls, there were guys too, but you're infringing on our comfort here, you know? Mm-hmm. You're getting to the point where, yes, we're in public. You need to understand that a safe space is not just safe for you. A safe space needs to be safe for everyone around you, and that includes you knowing not to get into people's faces, not to grab people's capes and stuff like that and flap them in the wind without their permission.
We put a lot of money into the cosplays we do. A lot of people do. Some people hand-make their own.
Yes.
Ruin it.
I think there was this horror story I remember hearing about this woman who made her wings out of actual melted wax. Melted wax and stuff like that into this beautiful sort of web crystal and stuff for like these fairy wings. And I do believe it was a Homestuck cosplayer jumped on her back. It was like, take me for a ride or something like that.
What the hell?
And broke her wings.
Who they does shattered. That to a person in general?
You want to know who does that to a person in general? The same person who...
Oh, yeah.
When I cosplayed Merrick one time, I had my Millennium Rod. It was this really cool Millennium Rod I had made. And I made it all myself. It was all gold paint, but it was wood and glass and really nice, like, gold accenting on it. And I thought it was so cool. I was so proud of it.
You spent a lot of time on it.
Oh, yeah.
We hunted down things for it.
Mm-hmm. And day I get there, one of the wings falls off. So I guess it wasn't all that great. But we
got it back on, though.
I was like, oh, cool. There's a repair station here. And they gave me some scotch tape. I was like, all right, good to go.
It was fine.
And this guy, out of nowhere, a big old grin on his face. He's like, hey, America, cool. Yep. And without missing a beat, he just looks down at my Millennium Rod and bink, flicks it with his finger, and that wing just
the whole top, the whole top came off.
And he just, whoops, sorry. Well,
what the fuck did you think was going to happen? That's exactly what I wanted to say, and I would have said it if he wouldn't have walked away.
Yeah, he was embarrassed.
I was about to speak.
And I just went, really, dude? I looked right at it, really? He said, whoops. He walked away. You, special situations.
You know, fair warning. I don't mind giving hugs and stuff, you know, to people who love the characters I cosplay. You know, mm-hmm. That's fun. That's fine. You jump on my back, I'm gonna break you. I'm just giving you a warning right now.
It's called con glomps. All right? Con glomps.
You won't be able to do another con glomp.
One of my favorites is the ones who are either incredibly scared of your character or incredibly in love with your character, so they won't approach you. So their friend comes, just so you know, she's in love with you. Points over to a girl hiding in the corner.
Well, I love the one your best, most successful cosplay, I do believe, is Orochimaru.
Mm.
It's also quite sexy. You scared that one girl, and her friend is like, yeah, she doesn't like you.
You really don't come over here, please. I wanted to just look at her and like give her the sneer and the tongue come out. I wanted to so much, but that can be misconstrued as abuse is the thing,
yeah,
to do that. So I opted not to, because for one thing, not only is it mean, but I could have gotten kicked out of the con if I did that. So, but yeah, I have a tendency to cosplay characters that girls absolutely are terrified of or hate.
But yet they make yaoi of them.
A few do.
I know, it's...
But, like, girls despise Orochimaru.
I love Orochimaru. God.
Girls despise Claude from Black Butler.
They don't like Claude because he rejected Alois.
Probably.
That's the reason. You know, Alois can do no wrong. He was a victim, don't you know? Even though he's not even real.
Well, I saw this one post one time that just went into just...
I've cosplayed Alois, by the way.
Yes. Just gushed this whole reasoning behind, you shouldn't do this because it's slut-shaming and stuff, and he's a victim, and you're blaming the victim. It's like...
He's not a real character.
Calm down. He's not real.
Yeah, do that for someone who's real.
Yes, please. Find a celebrity. Find a public figure who's gone through that and use them. Don't waste your energy on pixels, you know? God. It's like the people who talk down about anything yaoi and anything that depicts, like, somebody under 18. Oh, God forbid, the United States law of under 18. 17 and 9 months, you freak, you nasty bastard. How could you? You know? Like.
Yes.
But.
People take a lot of things too far and too personal.
to me, and I think I've said this before, but to me that's art, honestly. If art,
yeah, it is.
If a mass of pixels, if a mass of lead, if a mass of paint and whatever can drum up the emotions inside of you that you would actually get if it was an actual event or person in this situation, then art succeeds, in my opinion. Like, if that's why I consider things like Yowie, and why I even consider pornography art, because it's not real. No matter how, you know, romantic it is or whatever, or sexy it is, these people don't care about each other. And in Yowie's and hentai or whatever situation, it's not real. They don't exist. Mm-hmm. And yet, if you're getting turned on from it, or if you're getting angry at it, or if you're getting, you know, whatever emotion, if you can stir up an emotion in somebody through drawings, through pixels, art has succeeded, in my opinion.
Yeah.
So
any form of art or any creation that invokes any kind of emotion in you, whether negative or positive, is considered art.
In my opinion.
That is what art is.
Without being real. Like, it's not real. Yeah. That's why, like, somebody once asked me, like, well, where's the line drawn? Where's the line drawn? To me, where the line's drawn is when things are actually being harmed.
When people are being, animals, anything are being harmed.
Yeah, like I remember in the early 2000s, there was this big story about this artist who rented a room in a museum and just put a dog in it, and the dog was starving to death, and that was the art piece.
Yeah, that's
not art.
That is animal cruelty, and you can be arrested,
like,
for it.
Yes, it drums up emotion, but the emotion is from something that's really there and something that's really happening. To me, that's not art. When you're killing something, or you're cutting your own flesh, or you're mutilating yourself or something like that.
Yeah, we don't want anything like that.
You know, unless it's up to you, you know, unless you're doing it and stuff, like, to yourself, which, you know, tattoos and piercings and stuff like that, I'm totally okay with that being considered body art.
Oh, tattoos, but... yeah. And I also, a lot of people do not really get the fact that tattoos have been around for generations.
Oh, yes.
The ancient tribes did them.
The oldest body in existence, Otzi, who was found on the Austrian border, he had tattoos on him.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
It's been around in all the ancient cultures, so it's not just something that was invented in the last 50 years.
But, anyway, I love cosplaying characters who, like... I don't like playing the currently popular thing. I don't... Like, if... Say, like, when Attack on Titans came out, like, there was really no character in Attack on Titan that I cared for very much, and actually I gave up on the show after only a few episodes.
Yeah, but we both did.
Like, I usually like to kind of scope out what characters I'm drawn to most. Not necessarily the characters I think I can pull off, but the characters that I like the most.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the second part of it, probably, I shouldn't admit this, but sometimes the characters that I know people don't like, I sometimes feel the need to cosplay. Like, I feel the need to cosplay. I mean, I know I've cosplayed Inuyasha, and people love Inuyasha. And I've cosplayed Bunkotsu, and most people like Bunkotsu.
That was my idea. I loved you as Bunkotsu.
I've always wanted to cosplay Naraku. I've always wanted to cosplay a lot of other villains and stuff from Yu-Gi-Oh! I've wanted to cosplay characters from, like, Guilty Gear and things like that. And
oh, I know who you'd be perfect as.
Probably Undertaker, right? Is that his name, Undertaker?
Is that his name?
I don't
remember. No, Testament.
Testament. Okay, Testament. I'm thinking of someone else. But, yeah. I like playing characters like that. And the thing is... Take this into consideration. I'm not going to go around as Orochimaru trying to steal people's bodies, you know, or being a creep or constantly being in character and stuff. But that kind of goes back to our first topic, which was that, like, there are these people who take things too far and they don't consider your personal space, mm-hmm. and they don't consider what you're comfortable with.
I'm already taking going out of my personal zone, going to the con in general.
Mm-hmm.
Maya is the person who actually got me to do that. I never did anything like that before I knew him. My first cosplay, which some of you already know, but some you may not know, was Envy from Full Metal Alchemist Brotherhood. That is a very revealing and risky, daring cosplay to do. And it was my first one, and people really loved it. I think it's the one that got the most pictures of people's random cameras. Who knows how many people took that home and just stared at them. I have no clue. Remember how we used to find pictures of ourselves from people's uploads yeah. randomly on Tumblr or other places, and we yeah. and that would happen for months after a con.
That was always fun.
I even saw pictures of us from like standing off to the side that I didn't know people took of us. Mm-hmm. We weren't even posing or anything. We were walking down a hallway.
The funnest ones though were like the ones that were part of a conversation that you weren't privy to, where they would take pictures and below the caption would tag somebody and be like, "See, Stephanie, this is the guy I was talking about, the Duke Devlin." And then they just respond with "nice" or something like that. But yeah, that again, that comes down to like anime conventions for the most part are for introverts, I feel. Mm-hmm. As extroverted as it is to put yourself out there, to dress up, to wear sometimes rather revealing outfits, and to be gathered around talking about this one fandom or several fandoms with these people who you just met or may have only spoken to online or whatever, it's definitely your one chance to break through your barrier, to be normal. And mm-hmm. I think I've mentioned that before, that one of the most frustrating things about being an introvert is that very embarrassing conversation you have to save to yourself every now and then. And that is, that is there a risk that people won't know that I'm, or is there a risk that people will know that I'm not normal? And that's something that really sucks to have to admit, that you're not normal, and you're, this is your one chance when you go to anime conventions to be around people who are just oftentimes, not always, but oftentimes just as introverted as you. And this is the first time they've been out of their house in a month. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and back to the subject, that's kind of how it is for the Deadpool and Toby cosplayers, that they, this is their chance to be something they're not. I'm sure they're not total, you know, nut jobs when they're in private or when they're yeah. in school, but in a way, with that mask on and that wall sort of blocking their identity and stuff, they can be this psychotic character who just can do anything and run around and annoy people and they don't get in trouble for it.
I remember one time at one of the cons when I was as Envy, and I went to a few cons as Envy. We went to several. There was this one girl, I don't know what character she was supposed to be. She wore like a silver bodysuit, mm-hmm. and she had white boots on and some sort of animal ears or something. Maybe it was her own original character, I don't know. But it was the con where I bought my Ouroboros necklace. Mm-hmm. And she, I remember seeing her, she wasn't, I really didn't think she was like following me around per se, but I noticed that she would be like near some of the panels in the artist alley that we would go to, and eventually she did approach me, and her thing to approach me about was where I got the necklace. She didn't once look at the necklace at all while I was explaining it. She just looked at me and looked at me up and down, and I thought to myself, all right, hon, I know why you're here. And that does take courage. I appreciate it, mm-hmm. but there's not going to be anything else.
I have to admit,
she took a lot of courage to approach me like that, though.
I do have to admit, when I was single, there were times that I would I would be tempted to approach people and at cons and stuff like that, but I never did. So it does take a lot of courage.
It does.
And, you know,
when you go to a con, you're able to kind of come out of your shell, I think.
Yeah, you're able to be a bit braver and a bit more, have more conversation and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And you have, the coolest thing about a convention is that it's a lot like how people view band tees, which is like t-shirts of bands and stuff like that. You kind of feel like, hey, I can have a conversation with these people about something. Because oftentimes that's the hardest thing in the world, is to start a conversation with someone. And it's not out of embarrassment, and it's not out of like not knowing what to say. It's literally mm-hmm. about you don't relate on anything. Mm-hmm. And like, that's why, like, at my work, I've never really had a conversation about anything with anyone ever. Because
you don't know how to start it, really.
Everybody there is constantly looking at their feet, and they just they want the day to be over with. They don't want to conversate.
They're only there for money, you know.
Yeah, we all are. Yeah, we're all there for money. We're not there to socialize.
No.
I think this is a modern enough time that we can all now admit jobs aren't family and jobs aren't friends. A job is a job.
They won't always have your back either.
A business will literally I think I saw a quote recently that actually said that job that you're breaking your ass for and working till you die will literally replace you in a week after you die. So quit trying to push yourself so damn hard for them.
Mm-hmm. And don't think you need to be perfect for it either.
Mm-hmm. But like, imagine going into a work spot where you're allowed to wear like anything you want, and somebody comes in and they're wearing, you know, a Connie Francis shirt or something like that. Like,
I want a Connie Francis shirt.
I mean,
she's
imagine
my favorite
that.
Singer.
Imagine, or somebody has an Inuyasha thermos like I do, and then there's somebody there who likes Inuyasha. Yeah. You have a conversation. It's kind of like when I realize, you know, if I want to meet people who know things that I know about, I should wear shirts and stuff like that of the things that I like.
Uh-huh.
And I did. And then one night at the gym, somebody actually complimented me on it. I don't remember what it was. I think it was Metallica. I think I had a Metallica shirt on.
Well, that kind of makes sense. A lot of people still know Metallica. And, you know,
and he was like, whoa, Metallica. Cool, man. I was like, yeah, I actually really like this shirt. And like, I didn't have a conversation or anything, but it was one step towards it. It was one little step towards having a conversation. And it's like wearing a billboard that says, I like this. What do you like?
You know? Yeah. And you get that when you go to a convention. Especially if you're both dressed as a character from the same anime or something.
Yep.
You already have something in comparison with that mm-hmm. person that you both like. And sometimes you can find more things, sometimes you don't.
Sometimes, like, again, it's kind of annoying running into somebody who knows who knows the fandom and or knows the series, but they only know it through a certain fandom.
Yeah.
You know, like, oh yeah, Yu-Gi-Oh! Yeah, Purple Monkey Dishwasher, right? Oh, god damn it.
You know how many people...
I thought I found a Yu-Gi-Oh fan.
So many people thought that you were supposed to be a Shishomaru when you were Bankotsu for some reason. But there were a lot of people who did know who you were. But I don't know why they thought that. You didn't look anything like Shishomaru. You looked like Bankotsu.
Same colors. White with black in the center. Black and
gray. But Bankotsu has distinctive markings too. He doesn't. Shishomaru doesn't have a blue diamond on his forehead,
or a big old no joke.
Some people might disagree.
I'm trying to think. Was there ever a time somebody didn't quite know who I was? Also,
wasn't it Duke? No, people really actually knew who Duke was.
Yeah, a lot of people knew who Duke Devlin was. A lot of, you know, a lot of people didn't know who Claude was. actually.
Yeah, Claude. They thought you were supposed to be Sebastian.
Yeah, a lot of people thought I was Sebastian.
But you weren't. You wore Claude's glasses, mm-hmm. and
maybe if I'd gone around being a creeper and, you know, licking people's faces or I don't know.
Good Lord, I hope not.
Yeah. That would be if I was Deadpool or Toby.
Well, do you think that you pretty much answered what your brother wanted to know?
I think so, for the most part. I also... He wanted to know about the story. I think I can end it with this, the story about Naruto Shippuden.
Okay.
The big reveal that Toby is not quite who he says he is.
I think a lot of people know now, but there are some people who may not.
Okay, if anybody doesn't know about this, try to mute it.
Yeah, just mute it. Skip ahead about 10 minutes.
Well, maybe not that far. Well, a guy... I will put this out there that it's... And I don't want to say this to be mean or anything, but he was special needs. So I don't think that a lot of the times even people with all their cognitive faculties think things out. So it wasn't his job to think things out is the thing. You know, he's a perfectly functioning person, but he just doesn't think things out. But that's okay. There's nothing wrong with that. A guy approached me when I was dressed as, who was I dressed as? Oh, you were dressed as, Deidara, I think. And I was dressed as, I must have been dressed as Merrick, honestly. No. What was it?
Anytime we did Yu-Gi-Oh characters, it was always together. The Naruto characters that we have been, you've been Orochimaru, I've been Deidara, I've been Conan. Who were you when I was Deidara the one time? Weren't you Inuyasha at one point? I think I was Inuyasha.
I was Inuyasha that time. Well, here's the story. We should get on with the story.
Yeah.
A guy brings up Toby. Like, oh yeah, Toby's my favorite character. He's so crazy.
Yeah, he brought him up because I was Deidara.
And he said, yeah, I love Naruto Shippuden, especially when it turned out that Toby was actually, what's his name? The guy with the long hair.
Oh, Madara.
Madara, man. And he was just playing dumb all along. Man, that was amazing, huh? And I was just like, yeah, it's amazing.
You kind of spoiled it for me.
I'd never watched all of Shippuden. I was in the middle of it.
We still haven't finished it.
Yeah.
We're still in progress.
I was still in the middle of it, and it's just a good example of... Also, if you have to be having conversations, we're all there to have conversation, is the thing. Well, not all of us, but that's one of the funnest things about anime conventions is that we're there to have conversation. Don't always assume that everybody who is cosplaying a certain character has seen the entire series.
Mm-hmm.
I know that should go without saying. I know it really should.
But people don't always consider that, you know, when they're talking about it, because they see that you both love it, so that the excitement gets you first.
And, you know, that's not quite fair to even them when you think about it. Like... How do we know how many episodes they're in? You know, like, he didn't know if I'd watch 100 episodes or one episode. Mm-hmm. Or maybe you only ever saw Deidara from afar. You never actually saw the show.
There are people who have admitted they've cosplayed a character just because they like the way the character looked.
Just imagine if I approached any Yu-Gi-Oh! Bridge series fan and I revealed something about the series. They wouldn't know. They would be like, oh... I didn't know that. I haven't watched it yet. I've only ever watched the Abridged series. I've just spoiled the show for them. And, you know, that's something to kind of consider. You know, and make it simple. If you're ever at a con and a conversation comes up where you want to bring up a certain plot point, ask them, have you gotten past this point yet?
Yeah.
Think up a certain point and that doesn't reveal too much about the story and say, have you gotten past this point yet?
Have you gotten to so-and-so's arc, whatever? Yeah,
and if they say yes or no, continue the conversation. If they say, no, I haven't gotten that far, say, oh, okay, then I won't, don't worry about it. Because I don't want, it's going to be fun. I won't say anything.
You know, I bet the reason some of those people thought you were Sesshomaru instead of Bankotsu is because of the fact they didn't get that far. Inuyasha is an extremely long series, and Bankotsu comes out in like the 7th season.
Yeah, a lot of people may not know about it at all.
Yeah.
I mean, like, that would be like cosplaying one certain character in Pokemon or something like that out of the 1,000 episodes there have been.
One of the countless boys that he met while traveling, just he never saw again, but he said he would. Ash does that. Will we ever meet again? Sure we will. And then they part and they never see each other again.
There is a meme of, you remember the little Lynx boy from Inuyasha that he lives up in the woods with, or the mountains with, for one episode?
Yes.
There is a meme where he's shouting, we will meet again, won't we? And Inuyasha shouts back, no, you're just a single episode character, you loser. Or something like that.
Yeah. Yeah, I love Inuyasha. A beautiful, beautiful story. One of my favorite fairy tales in general. And yes, it is a fairy tale. It's called Inuyasha, a feudal fairy tale.
A feudal fairy tale.
All right, everyone. Let's move on to the next song break. I'll take you now to Domino Radio. Enjoy the music. Hello, everyone. Welcome back to An Hour with Domino. The song you just heard was Son of a Preacher Man by Aretha Franklin, one of my favorite hits of hers, actually. I wanted to pay respect to Miss Franklin, to play one of her songs on this episode today in her recent passing. And one day I hope to actually own it on vinyl and have it in one of my jukeboxes. The next segment that we're going to move on to is going to be talking about the world of creation, where I'm going to talk about my book. I said that I was going to promote it in this episode, and I'm intending to do that. Moonbeam is a sci-fi thriller, kind of slash horror thriller, set in the years of 1960 through 1962. Kind of like a period piece, but specifically during the Space Age. And it takes place mostly around New Mexico, particularly around the Roswell area. And when I was writing it, I have to admit that a desert is not really a place that I would typically see myself living, but I was so infatuated with this story that I really wanted to travel there, and I intend to actually go through Roswell someday when I travel Route 66 in the future. To me, a desert is a fascinating place. How many stories can you really think about where you can weave a story about a place that is so barren and kind of a wasteland? And that, myself, gives me a lot of mystery to it. Like, anything can happen out there. Stuff that could go on that nobody would ever know. It's kind of like the ocean. It's big and vast, and things happen out there that you probably would never know. And not only with my love of the 50s and the 60s and that era, and how people thought about certain sci-fi elements of the time, I started to weave together a very interesting story that I just really fell in love with. And I'm so pleased that my friend Rachel absolutely loved it. She's been doing some fan art for me. And Miah has read about half of the book, right, Miah?
I have. I have gotten about halfway through it in comparison to what you have written. Which is kind of hard to believe that, like, when I read it, like, just, like, you maybe went, what would you say, like a good 6 months or so without actually writing anything, just coming up brainstorming ideas and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And then you just had this huge burst of inspiration over the course of maybe like 2 or 3 months where you just wrote and wrote and wrote. And
I loved that feeling.
It was pretty cool. That was actually cool to witness.
I hope to actually get back into that.
So I'm literally like halfway into it. So, and I don't know if I'll have to start over with it, because I just have a bad memory anyway.
You can if you want to.
Yeah. And I may actually start over with it just to get a feeling for it.
We've mentioned it a little bit on the show before. Last few episodes I've talked about it, and Miah has actually been here a few times to talk about my writing and how he feels when he reads my stories and such. And I really love stories set in the past. I don't mind writing stories set in the future or the present, but I love writing stories about certain eras that I've always wanted to see but never had a chance to. And thinking about when I was writing about this story set in the desert, it had a very, I was going for a very isolated kind of feeling. You know, it follows mostly the central character. Her name is Wendy Fields. You follow her throughout the book, and for the most part, she is often by herself. Yeah, there'll be times when you'll meet other characters, but I really wanted to go for that isolation feeling. You know, what would you do if you were in this situation? And I know for some people it'll be kind of a very fantastical situation, but you'll see why when you read through it. And I remember when I was writing some of it, and I would give some of certain chapters to Maya, and he said that I've already seen like how if this was ever made into like some sort of motion picture or some kind of media of such, that you would know exactly how you'd want to direct or film it. And we were, that one part we were talked about the most, where Wendy was walking down the stairs in the dark. And you said that you really liked how I wrote that because it's really particularly hard to convey.
Yes. I rarely read books the way that a lot of people do. I envision it in my mind as a film. I actually do. I've always been that way. Even when I was a toddler, I dreamt in cartoon. I didn't have an actual dream that was realistic until I was maybe a teenager. All my dreams were always cartoons for some reason. And as I've gotten older, I noticed that when I would read stories, I would depict them as movies in my mind and how they would be directed, camera angles, actors and things like that. Mm-hmm.
I too have a passion for cinematography as well.
It's very rare that a book can only convey a certain situation through writing. Usually it's the other way around. To me, I find a lot of trouble depicting things through just words alone. I really do. It baffles me. I have to see visual example a lot of the time. And this was a situation where a visual example within my mind wasn't enough, that I actually had to read the book, and it made more sense that way. The situation in particular was this one particular scene. I won't give it away, but in a very dark room and depicting things within that dark room. And it's something that when I thought about it, it just could not be conveyed. It couldn't be conveyed through film. And through vision itself, it's something only you can feel, or you can only feel. Mm-hmm. It's something you can only experience one-on-one with your own eyes and with your own actual body to feel it all. So it's very interesting when a book can do that, when a book can only do what a book can do, you know?
That I do believe in respect for books. It can only be done in that way.
Mm-hmm.
Unless you experience it in life.
Last Sunday they make synthesizer books. Synthesized books.
It's goodness, like a real book. Would you want to almost psychologically experience that, though?
Probably not.
I bet some people would want to, for the thrill of it, but... Words are very powerful things. I've always felt that. I've always loved words, and it's probably not kind of a no-brainer that I became a writer, because I love making my own stories and my own characters and conveying them in my own way. Mm. I will give a link in the description for my book, which has been out since June, I believe it's when we published it. Yeah, mm-hmm. It's been published since June, so it's been out for a few months now.
It was pretty cool. It was pretty cool just to see it go from just a manuscript and stuff like that, and for you to have that big burst of inspiration, and then before I know it, it's actually published, a physical book in my hands. So,
and you designed the cover for me.
I did, and
I really loved it. Actually,
I wish it was a little bit better, just because of Amazon's printing processes. I don't know if that's my I don't think I should be allowed to say that, since it's not my project, but if it was my project, I would be very upset. I wish Amazon would print covers a bit more clearly.
The thing is, Amazon's printers, it prints everything a little bit darker than what you intend it to. So in order to counter that, when we do the artwork for covers, we have to make it lighter than what it originally is, so that when it does print, it will go back to the light setting we originally created it
as. Sometimes it's too light, and sometimes it gets blurry. And, whoa, sorry. bump my microphone. Sometimes it gets blurry and sometimes it just doesn't look right.
Yeah, it's something that they do need to work on in the publishing department, but I am very thankful for everything that they do.
Yeah, at the very least.
I am so glad to have a new publisher to where I actually receive my earnings and everything.
I would absolutely love for someday there to be something like that for music. And in a way, there is.
I hope so, too.
There is CD Baby and DistroKid and stuff like that. They do similar things like that for musicians. But it's a little bit more difficult just because you're dealing with, like, audio and you're dealing with a much more expensive process because you're dealing with plastics and CDs and downloads and cards. And it's so much more to have to deal with.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not impossible. And it is very close to what Amazon... And in fact, mark my words, Amazon probably will come out with something like that in the future for musicians. If they haven't already, because I do know that they make it possible to distribute anything, really. So if you have the album, they'll distribute it for you. But I think someday they will have music publishing options. If you are a musician, they will have a way for you to send your music into them, and they will mix it for you and print it for you and make it downloadable, give you CDs and records and everything.
I'd love for you to make some music and actually produce it on vinyl. I'd put that on my vinyl channel on YouTube.
I do really want that. I would really, really love that.
There, and as you finish Moonbeam, you'll realize that there's a character you've yet to meet, too.
That is true. I've met a few characters already, so it's very hard to believe. That is one thing I wanted to ask you.
Really?
Was this book the one where you decided to create a reoccurring character?
There is a reoccurring character within the world that the story is set in.
Mm.
So the book is not a sequel, nor is it a prequel to any other story. But there is a character that appears in it who appears in other books of mine. Because they're set kind of in the same world.
Mm-hmm.
So... I guess that's a yes and no.
At what point do you realize that this character belongs in another book?
Well, he's only ever known by one name.
Yeah.
And he has the same description. And I intend that purposely because in the future, after I finish the stories that he appears in, I think I plan to intend to make a book that will combine all of those stories, plus possibly his own origin. And I will give more details on that in the future. Okay. Right now, it's a little bit too much to really say without spoiling things. But I actually really do hope that you will like the other character you have yet to meet Moonbeam. Rachel says that she told me, I can definitely see why you wrote this character. And... speaking of creativity, not only writing and also music, I think I will end the show with the quote of the day. Being a singer is a natural gift. It means I'm using the highest degree possible of the gift that God gave to me to use, and I am happy with that. Aretha Franklin. I hope you all enjoyed the show, and we'll be back again at some point, don't really know when, hopefully not months from now. I intend to hopefully have a new one out before then. But I hope you liked being on here, Maya.
I always do. I always enjoy being here and having some conversation.
If everybody would like Maya to be on again, you can definitely say so. I'll have him on again. I notice that I do get more views when you're here.
Yeah, just because people want to hear me go on my little tirades that I go on. Like we recently did our a board game video on gaming on Domino Maya games, and we must have gone off on about 10 different tangents about things that had nothing to do with the board game. But I guess that's just our shtick. It just happens. We don't really mean it to happen, it just does.
All right, everyone. Bye for now.
Bye for now.